There have only been two milestone products in our industry, the Apple II in 1977 and the IBM PC in 1981. Today, 1 year after Lisa, we are introducing the third industry milestone product, Macintosh. Many of us have been working on Macintosh for over 2 years now, and it has turned out insanely great. And we are introducing Macintosh at a mainstream price point of $2,495. And you can go see a Macintosh in any one of our over 1,500 dealers in America today. I want to briefly cover some of the innovations in Macintosh. The first one is we've pulled Lisa technology down to a mainstream price point with its radical ease of use, mouse, windows, icons, pull-down menus, point, click, cut, and paste. We've managed to find a way to pull that down to a $2,495 price point. And Macintosh, to accomplish this, uses a 68,000 microprocessor, the same 32-bit microprocessor used in Lisa. It's necessary for Lisa technology, and it eats 8088s for breakfast. Macintosh comes with 192K bytes of memory. 64K bytes of ROM contains the entire operating system, the whole graphics foundation, and the entire user interface, all contained in ROM. There's 128K bytes of RAM. Just as the 5 1/4-inch floppy disk drive was an innovation in the 70s, the 3 1/2-inch disk drive will be the disk of the 80s. It is far safer, and we're storing over 400K bytes of information on one side of a disk that can be put in your pocket. Macintosh comes with two built-in serial ports. They're RS-232, RS-422, and an incredible thing called Apple Bus Interconnect. Macintosh has four voice sound and speech built in. And it communicates with you on a high-definition, super-crisp bitmap 9-inch black and white screen, which has over twice the number of dots on its screen of any current generation personal computer. You have to see this display to believe it. It's incredible. And all of this power fits in a box that is 1/3 the size and weight of an IBM PC. And we're introducing a family of products with Macintosh: the ImageWriter printer, an external disk drive, a modem, a numeric keypad, Macintosh carrying case, and a security kit so your Macintosh won't go anywhere without you. You've just seen some pictures of Macintosh. Now I'd like to show you Macintosh in person. All of the images you are about to see on the large screen will be generated by what's in that bag. talking about Macintosh recently. But today, for the first time ever, I'd like to let Macintosh speak for itself.
Hello, I'm Macintosh. It sure is great to get out of that bag. Unaccustomed as I am to public speaking, I'd like to share with you a maxim I thought of the first time I met an IBM mainframe. Never trust a computer you can't lift. Obviously I can talk, but right now I'd like to sit back and listen. So it is with considerable pride that I introduce a man who's been like a father to me, Steve Jobs.
The team that developed Macintosh is sitting up here in the first five rows, and they must feel awfully good right now. Well, we've got a lot of stuff to get through. Macintosh is targeted at two primary markets. The first is the 25 million knowledge workers who sit behind desks, and particularly those in medium and small-sized businesses. And the second market is the college worker. We think that's the knowledge worker of tomorrow, and there are over 11 million college students in America alone. Now, the telephone was the first and only really desktop appliance, and we think Macintosh can become the second desktop appliance for these tens of millions of people. Because of the 235 people in America, only a fraction know how to use a computer. Macintosh is for the rest of us. And we need to communicate this message to those knowledge workers and college workers. And to do that, we are launching the largest advertising campaign in Apple's history, which will premiere on the Winter Olympics starting February 6th. And I'd like to show you five commercials now.
It's more sophisticated, yet less complicated. It's more powerful, yet less cumbersome. It can store vast amounts of yesterday or tell you what's in store for tomorrow. It can draw a picture or it can draw conclusions. It's a personal computer from Apple, and it's as easy to use as this. Macintosh, the computer for the rest of us. Introducing Macintosh. It does all the things you'd expect a personal computer to do. It does a lot of things you wouldn't expect a personal computer to do. And it does some things no other computer has ever done before. Of course, to do all of this, you will have to learn to do this. Macintosh, the computer for the rest of us. The real genius of Macintosh, Apple's newest personal computer, isn't its 32-bit microprocessor, or that it captures the power of a mainframe on a board 10 by 10 inches, or even that it costs half as much as computers half as powerful. The real genius of Macintosh is that you don't have to be a genius to use it. Macintosh, the computer for the rest of us. You're about to see a few people learn to use the newest, most advanced business computer in the world. use it. Macintosh, the computer for the rest of us. This is a highly sophisticated office computer. And to use it, all you have to do is learn this. This is Macintosh from Apple, also a highly sophisticated office computer. And to use it, all you have to do is learn this. Now, you decide which one is more sophisticated. Macintosh, the computer for the rest of us.
This is KSTS TV 48 in San Jose, your computer connection.
Those ads were prepared by Shiat Day, our agency, the same people that did 1984. Over 70% of all the computers used in education in this country are Apples. And we feel pretty good about that. We care a lot about the educational process, and it reflects a bit of about what our values are as a corporation. And it's also an incredible leverage point for the Apple II. Now, most of those are in kindergarten through 12th grade. A year ago, we went in search of about a half a dozen colleges that would use a large number of personal computers in 1984, large being at least 1,000, campus-wide. We didn't find half a dozen, we found two dozen. And today I'm really pleased to announce the Apple University Consortium, formed of those 24 colleges and universities around this country. And they're the opinion leaders. They are the Ivy League. And they collectively have placed orders for over $50 million today of Apple 32 Supermicros. And this is the list of colleges. Stanford, Harvard, Dartmouth, Princeton, Yale, Brown, Carnegie Mellon, University of Chicago, Columbia, University of Pennsylvania, it goes on and on. Every major university in this country that's going to be using a large number of personal computers next year chose Macintoshes and Leases. And a ton of them are doing courseware development, and all of them are leading the way for the other 3,000 colleges in America. And they are telling us that Macintosh is the ideal campus computer. And we're really excited about this program. Now, when we first designed the Apple II in a garage, what most people don't know is we designed it to be built in a garage. And we thought if we ever built 50 a month, we'd be doing great. Now, we've obviously exceeded our expectations by over 2,000 times in the month of December. But never before Macintosh has a personal computer been designed from the start to be built in the millions. From day one on Macintosh, we kept manufacturability in mind and have designed it as the first personal computer to be built in the millions. And I want to take you very briefly through how a Macintosh goes together. We first take the front bezel, which is the most precisely tooled piece of plastic that Apple has ever manufactured, and to it we affix a stamped sheet metal part and the cathode ray tube. Next, we attach the single board containing the entire high-definition video electronics and the entire lightweight switching-type power supply. Next, the 3.5-inch disk drive is attached, followed by a shield around the disk drive. Next, the single 10-inch by 10-inch board containing the entire 32-bit digital graphics processing computer is slid into the metal infrastructure, and the cables are attached. And with four screws, the rear case is then put on, and the Macintosh is tilted up for the first time and ready to go into an automated 24-hour burn-in, after which the keyboard and the mouse are added. And the challenge for us is to do this once every 27 seconds. Now to do this, in addition to designing the machine, in the last year and a half, we have designed and built the machine to build the machines. We have invested over $20 million to build the computer industry's first automated factory in Fremont, California, overlooking Ford and GM. The factory is based on the concepts of just-in-time delivery of zero-defect parts. And it's a manufacturing process which allows extremely high-volume production of extremely high-quality products. And were it not for this shareholders meeting today, we'd be building over 500 Macintoshes. A Macintosh was developed by a small team of incredibly talented artists. And the rest of Apple supported this core group of about 100 people, and they were able to leverage the resources of a $1 billion corporation to create their dream. And I have never in my life had the privilege of working with such fine and talented people. And the experience of Macintosh has changed all of our lives who've had the privilege of working on it for the last few years. And we think it's going to change the millions of people, their lives, the millions of people that buy them in the next few years. And we made a multimedia show, really for ourselves, that I want to show to you now that captures some of the spirit of this group. And I'd like to show it to you now.
In a very tight-knit small group, and we had this dream. It was sort of us against the rest of the world, but we started working on it, and us 5, 6, 7 people believed in the dream, and eventually it sort of grew.
The machine is based on the Motorola 68000 microchip.
When we started working on Macintosh, we really wanted to get a unique synergy.
Firstly, there's 128K bytes of dynamic RAM. There are 64K bytes of ROM.
No compromise. Do it right. Do it really good the way you would want it, and then figure out how to make it cheap so people can afford it.
The display is a bitmap display. It has 512 by 342 dots.
And we all loved the machine so much that everybody was interested in the whole picture.
There is an interface for an external disk drive already built into Macintosh.
What I've particularly enjoyed about working with the people on the Macintosh project is the spirit of cooperation between the groups and individuals.
There's an engraving that is on the inside of the back cover of the Macintosh case that has everyone's signature that worked on the original design.
We looked at every detail, every small thing. Will this work in France? Will it work in Japan? When you're working on something as wonderful as Macintosh, you want to bring it out to the whole world.
It will come out and it will be, I think, several years ahead of its time. It is the best possible thing that could be done today.
People ask us, who is Macintosh for? We like to say that the market for Mac is the desk. Over the last few years, we've sold between 750,000 and 1 million Apple IIs, and that seems like a really large number. But even a bigger number is 25 million, and that's the number of knowledge workers in the United States alone who are sitting behind desks every day doing their work. And the way they do their work really hasn't changed since probably the start of the Industrial Revolution. So our marketing goal is really very simple, is to create a product that'll improve the life at the desk, to appeal to this vast group of people who know very little about computers at all. First of all, the Macintosh will have to be a very, very powerful computer because it has to handle lots of information processing problems for the knowledge workers. So the brains of the computer is the Motorola 68000, a 32-bit microprocessor. Our second concern has to do with ease of learning and ease of use. We've taken the mystery out of computers when you learn how to use a Macintosh. Our third concern is with the actual physical package, the thing you touch and hold. We want Macintosh to be the first desk appliance that sits with you at your desk in your office place. And last of all, we know we have to provide lots of very real solutions to those people at the desk. So we've come up with a wide variety of very good software applications like word processing, spreadsheets, databases, accounting packages, and because we're Apple, we'll be sure and toss in a few great games so you can have fun when the boss is not around. And in the years to come, we expect literally hundreds of new Macintosh applications to come from all the leading software houses all around the world. You know, for us in the Macintosh group, the product is like this torch being carried into a pitch black room. we like to say that it's simply incredibly, insanely great. Here, let me show you what I mean.
It's like the cursor is not connected to the mouse anymore. It's connected to your hand, and you're just moving your hand around.
Pointing with your finger.
The user doesn't have to get mucked up in the mechanics of how they want to do what they have to do. They can just go and do it and make it look neat and wonderful.
When you turn on Mac, what appears before you is a crisp black and white picture with a little bar across the top with words that suggest things you might be able to do.
When you find the command that you want to execute, you simply let up on the button of the mouse and that command will be executed.
A great number of the things that you see are little pictures called icons, symbols that actually allow a user to perform an operation that the symbol represents.
One of the starting points of Mac software is Bill Atkinson's amazing QuickDraw graphics package that's the heart and soul of not only Macintosh but Lisa. The reason we have multiple fonts is because the world has multiple fonts. We emulate the real world by providing a variety of type styles, just like you'd see in any well-typeset manual or book.
We built a machine that would be fun for us to use.
And fun doesn't just mean playing games. Fun means using a word processor, using a spreadsheet can be fun too.
Part of what we really want to do is recreate the Apple II phenomenon. There are several thousand extremely bright and talented software developers doing software for the Apple II, and it's an incredible competitive advantage.
In the software business, volume is everything. You want to be able to sell onto a large set of machines. Microsoft is choosing this Apple Macintosh environment because over time the other environments won't be interesting.
The technology that's in Macintosh makes it possible for us to move the state of the art ahead in software. We can really do something that's of value to people, to lots and lots of people, that we simply couldn't do before. And that's what's exciting, and that's why we're in business.
So we're going to devote at least half of our R&D resources developing software specifically for the Macintosh. And I wouldn't do that unless I really believed in, one, the product, and secondly, that we had a chance to have an outstanding relationship with Apple.
The manufacturing philosophy behind Macintosh started out as being able to find a way to make a truly high-quality, low-cost personal computer.
And that way is focusing on a quality improvement process. This improvement process has two key ingredients. The first being quality, being defined as conformance to requirements. And the second being a performance standard that focuses on zero defects.
So we've designed this whole process, the whole factory, at the same time as the product and with the product. And we're going to be making a computer every 27 seconds. That's 1,000 computers in an 8-hour shift.
And the way we're going to accomplish this high volume is through our working relationships with our vendors. And these relationships will focus on delivering us 100% quality parts.
Excited about is that we know Mac is sort of the next big revolution in the kind of tool that we can give to every person. When you think about it, you know, Over 750,000 people, well over 1 million people by the time Mac is introduced, will have gone through the less than fun experience of having to learn at least 50 bizarre words and will have had to have remembered dozens of sequences of esoteric commands. And I think once a tool like Mac hits, which eliminates the need for that, then you're going to see the numbers jump from really hundreds of thousands to millions to tens of millions. And that's what this next revolution is all about.
Macintosh was one of the worst-kept secrets in the world. But one of the best-kept secrets in the world is that we're not introducing just one standalone product today. Today, we're introducing a family of four new 32-bit products. We introduced Lisa 1 year ago, and it set the technical direction for the entire industry with its mouse, Windows, icons. We're seeing imitations, VisaOn, MS Windows, even a rumored IBM windowing package in the works. But today, we're introducing three new Lisas. The first is Lisa 2 with 512K bytes of RAM and a 3.5-inch disk for $3,495. The second new Lisa is Lisa 2/5, which has a 5 megabyte profile Winchester disk drive for $4,495. And the third new Lisa is Lisa 2/10. It has a built-in 10 megabyte Winchester disk drive, which sits right above the floppy, and it's priced at $5,495. Now, all of these new Lisas use the 3.5-inch floppy disk drive that is compatible with Macintosh. And there is an upgrade for all existing Lisa owners to upgrade their Lisa 1 to a Lisa 2/5 absolutely free. But perhaps the biggest news will be that all three new Lisas are 100% Macintosh software compatible. Now together, these four workstations form the foundation of the Apple 32 Supermicros, a family of compatible products based on Lisa technology and 32-bit architecture. And these four workstations span an incredible price performance range, with Macintosh as the key building block at $2,495 to Lisa 2/10, the flagship in performance, at $5,495. We didn't start Apple to build adequate products. And we didn't start Apple to simply put computers on the desks of computer-trained professionals to connect to IBM mainframes. What we wanted to do and what we want to do now is to build great personal computers and bring them to tens of millions of people. Never before has the time been riper, and never before, with our radically easier to use family of 32-bit products, have we been closer to doing just that. Thank you very much. I'd like to turn the meeting back over to Al Eisenstadt, who will give us a tally of the votes. Al?
Thank you, Steve. Before I get started with the tally, I'd like to make an announcement. It's a little bit unfortunate, but there are people in the back of Flynn, in the front of Flynn Center, who were not able to get into the auditorium. They arrived later. We had no admission cards, and they were not able to get in. The fire laws are such that even though there, you may look around and say there are wide aisles here, we were, because of fire laws, we were not able to fill those areas. Let me say in this in behalf of Apple. Last year, we had our meeting here, and there were between 1,900 and 2,000 people here. This auditorium holds approximately 2,600 people. That gave us about a one-third margin of safety. We felt that was adequate. Our proxy statements went out in plenty of time, so the opportunity to vote was there. We have collected proxies on the outside, so people had an opportunity to vote, even though they were denied admission here, which I truly regret. What we're going to do, and I'm making this announcement to all those here, as well as those who I believe my voice is being piped in outside, this entire shareholders meeting has been videotaped. We are going to arrange in the next month, sometime in the next few weeks, to run that videotape in a large auditorium, perhaps here if it can be arranged, perhaps a movie theater, a hotel, somewhere in the area. We will run announcements in the newspapers of this event. And for those of you who may be outside of the area, please drop me a note at Apple, and I will make certain that you get an announcement of the time and place of that event. Furthermore, we will have John Sculley and Steve Jobs present at that videotape in person, so that it, with respect to the question and answers and the opportunity to meet them, the president and chief executive officer, as well as the chairman of the board, and perhaps other members of the executive staff, will be in attendance. So you will have an opportunity to talk directly to them. I'm truly sorry for this. It certainly is not what we planned on, and it's unfortunate. Once again, my really heartfelt apologies. The inspectors of elections have completed their tally of the votes cast by the shareholders at this meeting. The results of the voting are as follows. Of the total number of shares eligible to vote at this meeting, which was 59,378,283 shares, 45,595,582 shares were actually voted. With respect to the three measures on the ballot, first, with respect to the election of directors, 4.7% of the shares eligible were withheld for the vote of directors, and therefore the lowest vote was 95.3% in favor of the vote of the election of the seven directors. No director received less than 95.3% of the shares cast. With respect to the amendment of the 1981 stock option plan, 76.1% of the shares cast were voted in favor of the amendment of the 1981 plan, 9.4% of the shares voted against it, and 14.5% of the shares cast abstained. Finally, with respect to the ratification of Arthur Young as the independent accountants for the 1984 fiscal year, 94.9% of the shares cast, of the shares cast voted in favor of the ratification of AY. 4.5% of the shares voted against, and 0.6 voted abstained from the vote. I'd like to thank all of the shareholders present here, as well as those whose participation was solely by proxy. And with that, bring the formal part of the meeting to an end. Do I hear a motion to adjourn the 1983 annual meeting of shareholders of Apple Computer?
So
Do I hear a second? All in favor say aye. All opposed? The meeting is hereby adjourned. As Steve Jobs mentioned earlier, we've set aside some time from questions from those present here today. So I would like to ask John Sculley and Steve Jobs to come out.
If there are any questions in the audience now, Steve and I will try to answer that. And I'll also announce that following the end of this question and answer period, our exec staff, who I introduced earlier, are available to answer other questions. So are there any questions from the audience? Yes, sir.
When you buy an ImageWriter printer, normally it's $595, but if you buy it with a Macintosh as a special introductory offer, it's $495, which means for $2,990, you get a Macintosh, an ImageWriter printer, and we're also throwing in the word processing and illustration software for a limited time only. So you get a pretty complete package. The modem, there are two versions. One is a 300 bit per second, and another is a 1200 bit per second, and they range in price from, I believe, $200 to $500. And the rest of the things, we could probably get you a price list after the meeting.
Repeat your question, please.
Excuse me.
That first question was, what was the price list for, or the prices for the peripherals and accessories for Macintosh? Any other questions? Yes, sir, back there. If you went out now and wanted to buy one, you could buy one, but you better hurry. Any other questions? We have 128K RAM on Macintosh. In the future, we intend to introduce a larger version with 512K when there is availability of 256K dynamic RAMs, which we expect to have in 1985. Well, we are fully able to manufacture Lisas. Earlier, we consolidate our manufacturing for Lisa into our Dallas facility. And we are building Lisas, we have inventories of Lisas, and we have converted what Lisa 1s we have and are still doing that process now over to the Lisa 2s. So we are able to supply the Lisa 2 slash 5 product right now, and the Lisa 2.0 and the Lisa 2 slash 10 will be available in the coming weeks. So the full line will be available starting immediately. No, we have no intentions of buying into Motorola.
We're more interested in their bits than their stock right now, so.
Yes. I'm sorry, what was the question? Independent software will be available starting today. Microsoft will be making announcements on that, and you will see ads appearing starting today from a number of independent developers. There are over 100 developers who will be bringing out software shortly, and we are very confident that we're going to recreate the Apple II phenomena of having a tremendous amount of software on Macintosh.
Just a few more.
Just time for one or two more questions. Yes, sir.
One of the strengths of the Apple II software base and one of the strengths that we want to recreate on Macintosh is that software will be done by thousands of companies, not just by Apple. And obviously we can't speak for those thousands of companies. And I think that's sort of the state of affairs right now.
We have time for one more question. The Lisa upgrade is available right now. That concludes the formal question and answer period. As I said, the executive staff is available for questions that you may have further. Thank you very much.
I hope you've enjoyed watching Apple's annual shareholders meeting, and I'd like to now give you a brief update of what's happened over the past month since we first announced the Macintosh. Starting on January 24th, dealers across the country were besieged with people coming into their stores wanting to see Macintosh and try it out for themselves. And ever since then, there's been a tremendous amount of activity as people have become more and more excited about this new product. We've had an opportunity to speak at a number of important conferences where major software and hardware developers have been in attendance, and I think there's a consensus building that Macintosh is going to be a major milestone for this industry. Super graphics, radical ease of use, are going to be the things that everyone is going to expect in the personal computers to come. Well, thanks to Channel 48 and to all of you for joining us. This has been a pleasure to show you Apple's annual shareholders meeting.
You're about to see a few people learn to use one of the newest, most advanced business computers in the world. If you know how to point, you already know how to use it. Macintosh, the computer for the rest of us.
Apple's Macintosh is an exciting development in personal computing, and teamed with Devong peripherals, the Macintosh becomes a powerful, flexible, and expandable business tool. The new Devong Mac Disk system provides from 5 to 32 megabytes of hard storage. And coming soon, Devong will offer a multitasking local